Good morning, Overbrookers, and welcome to the worship of our Lord at Overbrook Presbyterian Church this Sunday morning, October 18th, 2020. We are coming to you from the sanctuary here at Overbrook Presbyterian Church, and we are thankful to be worshiping with you wherever you are, whenever you're watching this recording. So let's worship God together, but before we do, Mary and I have a couple announcements about things going on in the life of the church. First off, we want to give a special thank you to all the folks who helped out yesterday with the drive-through food drive. We had a lot of people that were here collecting food and delivering that, and then we also had a lot of you that came through the line and delivered, dropped off food to be donated. Those donations will go to our local food banks to help families in need. So thank you very much for all of those who volunteered and for those who donated food.
We also have our Trunk or Treat event coming on October 25th here in the parking lot at the church, and registration is currently underway. We hope to have you, everyone, registered by October 21st, so one, we can make sure we have enough people willing to provide trunks. A new wrinkle is that we have gone up to red, the color alert level red in Franklin County, so we are watching that very carefully, and we'll be making a decision as we get closer if we need to change those plans a little bit. So when you register, make sure you leave some contact information so we can inform you of any changes to those plans as well. Tonight, if you are watching this on Sunday, October 18th, we are hosting our evening vespers in the parking lot outside at 5 o'clock p.m. Registration takes place online. That information was available in your Wednesday email from this past week, as well as information for next Sunday, October 25th. I remind you that we really need to have you register for that, so we make sure we keep our numbers limited to 50. But we are looking forward to seeing those of y'all who have registered this evening, and look forward to doing that next week as well.
And now we want to hear a special word on stewardship from a member of our stewardship committee, Ann Gibson. Ann?
Hi, I'm Ann Gibson, a member of the stewardship team, with a special message for you today. On September 25th, we started our season of stewardship. Everyone received a letter and a pledge card asking you to support our church by indicating how you will share your time and talent to make a difference. This year, the theme is Serve God and Serve Others. Debbie Ryan shared signs of stewardship with us, and last week, Steve Helditch reminded us we're all part of the church team. Next week is Stewardship Sunday, and our time of pledging will be drawing to a close. We hope all of you have returned your pledge cards to indicate how you can share your time and your treasure to help Overbrook Church serve God and serve others. Overbrook needs your financial support to continue the ways that we connect with each other as a congregation and also connect to the world outside our walls. Your time is also valuable, so please let us know what you would like to do to serve God and serve others in 2021. If you haven't returned your pledge card yet, please do so this week. If you come to Vespers on Sunday evening, you can bring it with you and drop it in the box. Or you can use our newest option of going online. Just go to overbrookchurch.org, and on the homepage, click on Give. And on the next page, you'll see Stewardship Pledge, and at the bottom of the paragraph, Online Stewardship Pledge Form. Click on that, and this comes up, and you can fill in all the necessary information, your name and address, etc. Then at the end of that, there's a time and talent survey, and we hope that you'll take time to fill that out as well. It's quick, easy, and secure, and you don't have to go to the mailbox. You don't have to buy a stamp. You can sit at your computer in your pajamas. The point is just to do it. For everyone who has already pledged, we thank you. For those who have not yet done so, I encourage you to think of all the ways that Overbrook Church has impacted your life, and how you can use your time, money, and talent so Overbrook can continue its message to serve God and serve others.
Thanks, Ann. So everybody remember that next Sunday, October 25th, is Stewardship Dedication Sunday, so we're hoping to get everybody's pledges in by the 25th, if not on that Sunday. Now we come to a part in our service where that has always been important when we're together, and is just as important as we're apart, and that's passing the peace. So we've encouraged you, and we continue to do so, that this week to make a phone call to three people or so that you would have normally seen worshiping here in the church and pass the peace of Christ to them. And then also spend a little time catching up and checking in on each other, being the church together. So the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you, Mary.
And also with you, Bill.
And also with you. Let's worship God together.
My younger friends to come a little bit closer. I'm here in our traditional worship space, sitting on the stairs where we normally have our time for children. And I'm sad that you're not here with me, but I trust that you are home where it is safe. And at some point in the not super distant future, maybe more future than we want, we'll be able to be together. I don't know when, but I hope it's soon. But no, I'm missing you and thinking about you. I also was thinking about games. I love to play games. I think they're very fun. At our house, we like to play games like I Spy or do scavenger hunts. Those are kind of fun. A new one we have, Find Five, which might be Find Five Things That Are Blue, or Tell Me Five Names of Animals You Find at the Zoo, or Tell Me Five People Who Are Your Friends. Those kind of things. Those are kind of fun. So today we're playing a game, Where Do You Find? I'm going to tell you something, and you tell me where you find it. So if I said teacher, where would you find a teacher? In school or at school, although right now sometimes that's on the computer too, because we're doing a blend of that. If I said doctor, where do you find a doctor? Doctor's office? Hospital maybe? Where do you find a police officer? Maybe at the police station, or in a car driving around, or out in your community. Okay, where do you find your mom and dad? Maybe right next to you right now, but where are you? You're in your home, right? Okay, where do you find Jesus? Now, I bet some of you said the church, and that's a good answer, because we do learn about Jesus, and we find pictures of Jesus. Do we find Jesus himself sitting in church? Maybe not the way you would see your mom or dad or brother or sister or your teacher or your doctor. But how do we see Jesus? We see Jesus in each other, in the ways that we care for each other, in the ways that we show love to each other. So we do see that at church, right? But Jesus' love in Jesus is not just at church. Jesus is everywhere because Jesus' love is everywhere, right? Out in our world. And it's how we treat people. We see Jesus
because of how we treat people, how we love people, how we care for people. Every time we are kind to someone or share with someone or see someone being kind or see someone sharing, that's Jesus working. That's when we see Jesus, right? Where can we go where Jesus isn't? Is there a place we can go where we can't see Jesus? God tells us, no, that's just not possible because Jesus is everywhere. Everywhere, reminding us to love with our words, with our actions, and in every single way. There's no place we can go where Jesus isn't. And that is really cool. So if I ask you again, where do you find Jesus? Your answer should be absolutely everywhere. And what a great gift that is. So will you remember that even when we're not together at church, even when you're at home or at school or playing in your backyard, even when you're asleep at night, Jesus is everywhere, loving and caring for us and asking us to love and care for everybody else, because that's how we help other people see Jesus too. Will you pray with me? Dear God, we thank you for this day, for loving us in every way. Help us to love and not to fuss, because we know that you love us. Amen. I hope you have a great day, and I hope I get to see you really soon.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus. That's the book of Ephesians. And we're going to be reading from chapter 1, verses 15 to 23. Now, this morning, I'm going to be using Eugene Peterson's paraphrase of the Bible, The Message. Paul is a great writer and has written so much of the New Testament, but oftentimes with the clauses and subclauses and the complicated way that he writes, it can be kind of tough to understand him. Eugene Peterson, though, breaks it down in a really easy, clear way to understand what it is Paul's trying to say. So we're going to be reading from Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus from the very beginning. So we're early on in his letter. We're still kind of introducing things. And we're going to be reading from chapter 1, verses 15 to 23. So listen for the word of the Lord as it comes to us from the book of Ephesians. When I heard of the solid trust you have in the Master Jesus and your outpouring of love to all the followers of Jesus, I couldn't stop thanking God for you. Every time I prayed, I'd think of you and give thanks. But I do more than thank, I ask. Ask the God of our Master Jesus Christ, the God of glory, to make you intelligent and discerning in knowing him personally, your eyes focused and clear, so that you can see exactly what it is he is calling you to do. Grasp the immensity of his glorious way of life, the glorious way of life he has for his followers. Oh, the utter extravagance of his work in us who trust him. Endless energy, boundless strength. All this energy issues from Christ. God raised him from death and set him on a throne in deep heaven, in charge of running the universe, everything from galaxies to governments. No name and no power exempt from his rule, and not just for the time being, but forever. He is in charge of it all, has the final word on everything. At the center of all this, Christ rules the church. The church, you see, is not peripheral to the world. The world is peripheral to the church. The church is Christ's body, in which he speaks and acts, by which he fills everything with his presence. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious and merciful God, we give you thanks for this day and for this time together. And we pray that during this time, you would help us to feel your spirit among us, wherever we are, whenever we are watching this, that by your Holy Spirit, you would open our hearts and our minds and our eyes and our ears, that we may hear your word anew and come to understand your will for our lives more fully. We offer this prayer in Christ's name. Amen. On Tuesday of this past week, Mary and I went down to the Franklin County Board of Elections, and we cast our votes. All told, it was a quick and painless experience, really. Everyone social distanced, everyone wore masks, and it was really, really fast. The line, when we got there, wrapped all the way around the building. But from the time we got in line until the time we were walking out with our cool new Ohio vote stickers, it all took just 40 minutes. So there's two things I want to encourage you to do today. The first is I want you to vote. Early voting has already started, but if you don't feel comfortable going in to vote in person, you can still request an absentee ballot up until noon on October 31st. But however you do it, please vote. You see, I believe voting is important, and I believe it's important for several reasons. Voting is a right. Voting is a privilege. Voting is a responsibility. But voting is also a spiritual discipline. Now, the Bible says nothing explicit about voting or how to participate in a democracy. That's because government in the Old Testament was largely autocratic or tribal. And at the time the New Testament was written, that part of the world was dominated by the Roman Empire. The right to govern was seen as coming from God and not from the consent of the governed. So while there is some scriptural advice on how to be a citizen in a monarchy or an empire, there is none on how to vote in a representative democracy. But that's not to say there's nothing in scripture to guide us through this potentially harrowing process, which brings us to the second thing I want you to do. I want you to consider what Jesus calls us to do and be, and then let your vote be an extension of that belief. Now, there are a lot of people who are going to cry foul here. Separation of church and state, they'll say, we shouldn't bring our religious beliefs into our political lives. But I believe that's a misunderstanding. Let me put it this way. Do you remember those little lunch trays they used to use when we were in elementary school? The ones with the different sections for different foods? There was one for your milk carton, another one for your Salisbury steak, a smaller one for your vegetable. Everything was kept separate in its own place. Well, sometimes we like to keep our lives compartmentalized like those little trays. Church stuff over here, hobbies over here, family in the middle, election stuff over there. But if you remember those trays, then you also remember that sometimes the cafeteria worker would slap a big old spoonful of something messy on your tray, like applesauce, that would slop over into all the other compartments. Well, we may like to keep our lives compartmentalized, like those trays. But as disciples of Christ, our loyalty to God and Jesus' lordship over our lives is like that big old sloppy scoop of applesauce that doesn't stay in its little compartment, but comes sloshing out all over everything else. When we say that Jesus is Lord of our lives, that means all of it. If you're a disciple, that means there is not a single section of your life that shouldn't have at least a little bit of Jesus in it. Besides, the separation of church and state only works one way. The First Amendment to the Constitution of the United States says this: Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. That means Congress cannot create or endorse a particular church or set of beliefs. It doesn't say anything about your ability to bring your religious beliefs into your participation in the political process. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. got involved in the civil rights movement as an expression of his faith in Jesus Christ. William Sloan Coffin dedicated his career as a Presbyterian pastor to fighting injustice as an expression of his faith in Jesus Christ. Every day, Christian people advocate and work for fair housing and equal access to health care and racial justice as an expression of their faith in Jesus Christ. Now, I've also been told before, I don't like to hear politics from the pulpit. But unfortunately, Jesus Christ was very political. By being Messiah, Jesus, by definition, posed a challenge to the political powers and principalities of his world. Jesus called people to be loyal to God's kingdom, not the Roman Empire. The Romans, you see, didn't crucify Jesus because he was blasphemous. They crucified Jesus because he posed a threat to Roman civil authority. Our politics and our faith interact because they address so many of the same things. We vote and pass laws on important matters like how we work, where we live, how we treat one another all the time. And that makes those things political. But our faith also guides us on those same issues. So it should be almost impossible to keep them apart. And when they do collide, it should be our faith that influences our politics, not the other way around. Now, in the passage we read this morning from Ephesians, Paul makes it clear that Jesus is Lord, not just of the church, but of all that is. That means in every part of our lives, we submit to the guidance and authority of Jesus Christ, not just some of the time, not just in some things, but in everything. And that includes our votes. You know, if we think of our lives like those little elementary school lunch trays I was talking about earlier, then we have to expect the applesauce of Jesus Christ to get all over everything else on our tray, whether we want it to or not. Monday morning commute, applesauce. Thursday afternoon yoga class, applesauce. Wednesday night Zoom meeting, applesauce. Tuesday in the voting booth, we should be covered, dripping, swimming in applesauce. If we are disciples of Jesus Christ and we believe we should live as he taught, then the government we choose to represent us should also reflect our dedication to what Christ teaches us to do and be. And we desperately need that. It has become clear to me that people of faith need to be more active in the way our country and our communities are governed. Some more fundamentalist Christians don't seem to have a problem with that. Pollsters even refer to evangelical Christians as a voting bloc. But I think it's time for the rest of us to get involved too, because our elected officials seem to have lost track of Christ in their governing and decision-making. Because Jesus healed the sick and the infirmed. Jesus brought sight to the blind and gave crippled people the ability to walk. He cured a little boy's epilepsy and a woman's 12-year flow of blood. The health and well-being of human beings mattered to Jesus. Yet in the midst of a global pandemic, we've become a nation where the most basic and effective means of slowing transmission of the virus is often minimized. And those who advocate for those basic safety measures are ridiculed. We've become a nation that is, again, in the middle of a pandemic, fighting in court to overturn a law that provides health care coverage to millions of people who would otherwise not have it. That's not a government guided by the authority of Jesus Christ. Jesus taught that the greatest law is to love God with all your heart and soul and mind and strength and to love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus taught that we are also to love our enemies and to pray for those who persecute us. But we've become a nation divided against itself, where hate groups are emboldened and those in office seek to deepen divisions for the sake of their own power. And we've enabled them to do so. That's not a government guided by the authority of Jesus Christ. Jesus taught that we are to welcome the stranger. And he bid the little children come to him, because to such as these belong the kingdom of God. Yet we've become a nation that turns away the stranger, separates them from their children, and then holds those children under lock and key. That's not a government guided by the authority of Jesus Christ. Jesus taught that he came as an expression of God's love for all the world, for everyone. He didn't draw distinctions between people, but loved and served them all regardless of gender and race. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world." Jesus stood for justice and freedom from oppression for all people. But we've become a nation where injustice and oppression are often tolerated in the name of law and order. That's not a government guided by the authority of Jesus Christ. Jesus taught that you can't serve two masters, because you're going to love one and hate the other. He said you can't serve God and money. And Jesus taught us not to build new barns to store up our abundance, but to share what we have and thus store up treasure in heaven. Yet we have become a nation willing to sell its soul for a tax cut. That is not a government guided by the authority of Jesus Christ. But we can change all that. We can work to overcome what we have allowed. We can atone for our sins as a nation and redeem our poor choices of the past with better ones in the future. And that begins with voting. Each of us must make our own choice, and so I encourage you to make yours. But the choice we make should be one that we would be absolutely confident explaining to God face to face. Now, I know it'd be naive to think that every politician would be attuned to the will of God, and that every voter would be voting in the interest of God's kingdom. But in so much as we have a voice in how our community, our state, our nation is governed, as disciples of Jesus Christ, we would be negligent in not taking that opportunity and treating it as an act of discipleship and a spiritual discipline. As with everything else in our lives and everything else in this world, what we do in the voting booth is subject to the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ. May our discernment lead us to your will, O God, and may our efforts in seeking to follow you and work towards your kingdom be always consistent with what you would have us do and be. To God be all glory, honor, power, and dominion in this world and in the world that is to come. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us join our hearts together in prayer today. Creator of all things good and holy, we come before you this morning with deep gratitude for so much in our lives, for health and companionship, for laughter and joy, for connection to others in the so many ways that it comes. We especially offer thanks this day for this church, for the space to worship, even when it's online, and more importantly, for a community that strives to make each and every child of God know they are valued and loved and integral to our world. We are thankful for the many ways your Spirit still moves in and through and among us today, for your Spirit that makes itself known in big and bold ways, as well as the small and almost minute actions of our daily routines. So we come before you this morning, O God, to pray for our world, a world that continues to wrestle with conflict. Protests over unjust systems and practices and governments continue. Violence against those who are seeking peaceful ways seems to have become the norm. So we pray, O God, for those who are protesting, for police officers and aid workers hoping to make sure protesters are safe, and for those caught in the middle of any conflict. Move among and with those speaking out, and bring resolution and ways forward that enable voices to be heard without violence. And we pray, O God, for all forms of peace, peace from violence, peace from fear, peace from anger, peace from injustice, and peace, O Lord, just your peace. We also remember this day our neighbors who are hurting, for those who are ill or who are grieving, for those who are tired or sad or overwhelmed, for those who are waiting for test results, and those preparing for surgery. We lift up those who help heal, the doctors and nurses and hospital staff, rehab and home health aides, and family members, all who help coordinate so much care. Fill all of them with health and wholeness, and may each of them be surrounded by your comfort, your compassion, and by an abundance of people who show forth your love to them. And we pray for those who find themselves hurting in other ways, those without a job, those who cannot find or afford childcare, those fighting to pay their bills and feed their family. We pray for our neighbors who experience oppression and injustice, our neighbors who are targeted because of race, gender, nationality, and religion. We pray for those who stand up and speak out against all discrimination and those who work tirelessly to change systems of oppression. May your presence be known by all who fight for justice and equality, and may each person affected by injustice be assured of their worth, not only in your world, but in ours too. Gracious God, move within all of us, stirring your Spirit in ways that are inspiring and challenging. And may each of us discover strength to live into your love that surrounds each and every one of us, and use that love to bring about the kingdom that you envision. We make this prayer in the name of the one who loves us unconditionally and taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Well, that concludes our service for this week. Thank you for being with us and for worshiping with us. We look forward to seeing you again next week. Now go. And as you go, may the grace of God the Father, the peace of Jesus Christ, God's Son, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with us all, now and forever. Amen.